I was Deb Davies back when I was growing up in Surrey as an eighth grader going to punk rock shows. And in the tradition of analog social media, I started to make a fanzine. And a fanzine is really boring without pictures. And there was one person that took pictures of all these punk rock shows that I went to see, and that was Bev Davies. And Bev Davies was kind enough to provide to young publishers all around the world these awesome photos of Vancouver scene. Between the 70s and into the mid 80s, she shot everyone who came through Vancouver of any consequence scene. So it's my great pleasure to introduce my first panelist, Bev Davies. My second panelist, I was at Gnomedex for the first time, and I've been doing this internet stuff for a long time, and just starting to see that there were some neat paradigm shifts going on out there. And I'm sitting at this chair having a beer, and this guy walks up to me and says, "Hey, you're that weed guy." Snap, snap, snap. And from then on, we've been doing a lot of projects together, and over the last 4 years, Kris and I have collaborated on a ton of projects, both professional and artistic. And I keep on learning new stuff from him, both in terms of style and substance. So here is the poster boy of Northern Voice, Kris Krug. Now, to be honest, it took me a little bit of thinking to how to approach this, because both of their photos I have a lot of emotional connection to, because a lot of cases that was me and I was there and I was hanging out in case of Kris while he's taking the pictures, in the case of Bev being at these same shows. But I really wanted to kind of bridge both their artistic styles that really stretch over a couple of different decades. But as I started going through their photos, I started to see really a lot more similarities than I did differences. So with that, let's kick it off here, Peter, and we're going to jump into the first picture. Actually, you know what? I set this up totally wrong. I messed this whole thing up. I'm just going to bring you guys over here so you can actually see the pictures that I'm talking about a little bit. Bev, let's see Scoochie around here. I'm much better standing up anyway.
Yeah,
there we go. Now that you've seen Bev from the front. Here you go. So here we have Exhibit A, which is Michael Stipe, REM. Bruce Dickinson, Iron Maiden, 2 minutes to midnight. Some nice stuff. Now, I'm going to start off with, I'm going to finish up with some more kind of technical stuff about making shots and making the photos, because I know all the photo geeks with your giant lenses will be like, "So where do you stand and what aperture do you use and all that?"
I'm thinking about you.
But I wanted to start with something a little bit bigger than that, which is, why is it that you're taking these photos? Bev, in your case, back in the day, you were usually the only camera at a lot of these shows. But Kris, in your case, you're there at South by Southwest in a pit with a bunch of other people with all these giant lenses shooting sight. So let's start with you, Bev.
Well, giant pit, whole bunch of other photographers. No, probably just the sun in the province and me, because I was working at the Strait then. That's like a magic photograph for me. I posted it 2 minutes to midnight. I threw it up on Flickr at 2 minutes to midnight on a New Year's Eve. I was just fooling around and thought, oh God, I'll put up the Bruce Dickinson. And I actually got it up like maybe 5 minutes to midnight or something like that. But the punk stuff that you're talking about is, yeah, quite often I was the only camera there.
When you're shooting these pictures, were you thinking of a sense of history and what these were going to stick around for a while, or did you think of it as ephemeral?
I was collecting. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure what I was collecting for, but I was collecting.
Now, Kris, there you are at South by Southwest. Mm-hmm. Everyone's shooting Stipe. And in fact, I remember while we were there at that conference, the next day they had Stipe on the cover of this magazine. We're like, dude, you had 20 shots better than this one. Why are you there if everyone else is there?
Well, I feel really lucky to get to go to a lot of places I get to go to, Fashion Week and South by Southwest and stuff. And so I just try to document as much of it as I can to show back my friends what I've seen and my perspective and stuff. Michael Stipe, I grew up listening to REM. It's pretty much my favorite band with U2, my first boy crush. And I got to meet him after this. I felt pretty lucky. But yeah, I'm just trying to kind of keep a record of what I've been up to and where I've been.
Well, not to inflate your own coolness, but he was staying down the hall from us at the hotel. Peter Bach in the elevator. All right, let's get the next one here. Because I got a ton of these. This was incredibly hard to go through these pictures and try and whittle them down. But this makes me think, like, who are you taking these pictures for? Are you taking them for yourselves? Are you taking them for the fans? Are you taking them to expand the reputation of the artist? Or are you taking them
for a message to future self?
Good question. No idea.
And what the hell happened to this guy? He looks almost as bad there on the left and he does it at the right 20 minutes later.
I have a real crush on men that wear eye makeup. As soon as I see one of them with like that kind of black eye makeup, it's like, oh my god. Oh my. So Green Day, of course, is my heart. But a friend of mine was in the hospital, and DOA opened for him both nights at the Commodore, where this show was taken from. And this was taken the first night. And I printed the picture off. I printed off two copies of it and took one down to my friend that was in the hospital door and gave him one because he couldn't go to the concert, and took the other one back and the next night and gave it to Iggy.
So it's not
and
like...
I probably gave one to the straight.
Whereas Kris took this picture, put it up on Flickr, and instantly thousands of people had that picture almost instantaneously. Scales had some great pictures from the same show that were almost otherworldly looking.
Well, one of the things I think this, that there's commonality between Bev and I is, even if you don't think so, I think that you really helped to cohese a scene together and providing one of the pillars on which a kind of a scene can be established, which is you took all these photographs, you documented, and you got it into other people's hands so they could write about it, so they published as fanzines. And by doing so, you're kind of one of the pillars of which the whole movement took place on. I mean, without a photographic record of it, it would have been, you know, a lot less documented, maybe less meaningful, less of a cohesive identity. And so I'm trying to do kind of that as well. I try to get my stuff. I like to try to capture what I see while I'm there. I have a really bad memory and I have ADD, so it's like helpful for me to remember what I've been to and what I've seen and to photograph it. And also, like, sometimes I can't just enjoy it if I'm just standing there just trying to take it all in. So for me, taking pictures of it helps me to enjoy it on a different level. And then I like providing that to other folks so that they can do remixes and mashups, articles, coverage, fan stuff for things that they were there for.
Awesome. Timmy, with the next one, Peter. All right, what's the difference between, now I picked these ones. Some of these, as I put my little wine and cheese pairings together, I started to kind of like, because I'm not a technical photographer, and who am I? I'm not so, you know, I don't have some black turtleneck, I'm not an art critic. Like, how do I compare this? Because I started just, you know, by getting to know their personalities, I started to see these kind of common threads. In this case here, I know Beth's a big fan of Brian Jonestown Massacre up there, and I know this is a quintessential. I mean, you know, you can see that picture anywhere and know who took that picture. That's, to me, that's classic Kris Krug kind of picture. That's the kind of person you like taking a picture of. And that's a great looking shot. But where, there's a line at some point where you're going to show a band that you love, and you're going, oh my god, I get to shoot this band, D-Way or R.E.M. or something. And then sometimes, and this isn't the case with these, but certainly is, where you're going to band for, yeah, I'm here, I might as well shoot it, or it becomes a pain gig. How does those perspectives change your approach to shooting the band? Anyone?
Hey, someone willing to give me money to take pictures? Woo, what a concept. Have you thought of that?
Sometimes when I'm getting paid to go shoot something, like when I went and shot for Rolling Stone a couple of times, it's like I bracket my work more than I would if I was just doing it for myself. Like, I mean, I try to get all the shots that they might be interested in, so I try to shoot everybody individually, and I try to shoot one that gets everybody in it, and then I try to do the you know, the kind of most popular or most in demand, like the lead singer usually, get the most of them. But, you know, this is a film shot, and this wasn't, like, a paying gig or anything like that, and so I prefer to do it that way. I tend to, like, leave the concert, like, before the end of it and kind of sneak backstage so that I can get them right when they're coming off backstage. This is when I got this one with him still super sweaty, right? He's changing his shirt, I think, between what he wore during the show and what he's going to go out and do the encore in or whatever, so I like catching those kind of personal moments backstage.
There's also a pressure to get a good photograph, whether you work for a magazine or a newspaper, or you're doing it for yourself. I mean, I've done all of that. And when I got that photograph of Anton, he's never coming to Canada again. He's never coming to Canada again. Never doing a show in Canada. When I got that photograph, there was the feeling, like, you know, they're going to throw me out of the pit any minute. And I got a photograph, like just one. That's all I care about, is getting one. Getting one that really matters somehow.
Thanks. Peter? Yeah. Oh, give the drummer some love. Look at this. Your mom take a cool picture of you backstage with Bruce Dickinson?
That's my son.
Uh-huh. This kind of goes back to...
Sometimes I couldn't get a babysitter, you know.
You just need to be backstage at the Iron Maiden show, the roadies will take care of them. To me, these will say these are personal shots. You know, this shot here, I was at the show with Chris and Liam Finn from New Zealand, who was one of those guys from South by, that was just totally reinvented anything you thought of music, where he was playing loops, getting things on guitar, putting the loops on, going back behind the drum set, getting all animal. And to me, this looks like a fan shot. That's not something, you know, the thing in the back. Yeah. But this seems to me like this is you capturing an image for yourself rather than capturing it for the people out there. And did it with this. You're not going to put the kid, well, you weren't going to exploit your kid. I guess I just did. But he's not. But this to me says the joy of photography and like the joy of doing it because you love it. Say that's the case.
That was a fun, sweaty-ass show. I mean, we were like packed into the front. We couldn't leave until it was over. So
yeah.
That one was awesome. And he was really serving it up, like you said, yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't leave till this was over either.
All right, hit me, Peter. All right. Now, there's ways to take different shots. And the reason I grabbed this one here, you have this great fuzzy thing, and then you have this back here. And here, Chris, I see you carried 40 pounds of gear with you all the time. Is this the reason why? So when you come across something unexpected, this doesn't seem like your regular rock and roll.
Yeah, this was unexpected. We got invited to a party from Gypsy Forest after South by Southwest after party in the middle of the night, and this was some of the fire and belly dancers there. But when I first got into photography, I kind of like, there quickly after shooting a lot of photos, there came this point where I had to make decisions. I had to either be happy like missing the best shots of my life because I didn't have my camera, I had to be okay with that, or I had to carry my camera here with me every single place that I went.
Where's the camera gear right now?
It's just outside the front desk.
He scatters it around the conference center, puts a camera in each room, so he can just bring them to the front
desk. No, don't bring them to the front desk. My camera's been returned to Lost and Found 3 times today. It's where they're supposed to be. Don't turn it into Lost and Found. Yeah, so I just decided to take it with me everywhere. You know, I make the joke that hopefully someday Bono will call me up and say, be at the airport in 2 hours and I'll be able to roll with everything.
He just totally stole the joke I was going to use on the Bono picture. Oh, damn. Bono picture. You didn't shoot pictures for quite some time, for maybe like 86 until maybe...
I tend to think that I fell asleep on the couch and woke up about 15 years later.
You didn't miss much. The 90s was horrible.
I do wish that I had photographed the Seattle scene at that time. I mean, it was so vital, it was so amazing. And I did get to go see Nirvana, but I didn't get to take camera. Mm-hmm.
It
was murder.
Yeah. All right, we'll move on from that. Courtney Love has got a cadre of lawyers, so I don't want to.
This is the Thrill Kill cult.
Yeah.
And they're out on their last tour, evidently, and that's the first time I've seen them, and they were totally awesome. And it sort of was drilled into my head because I have a wonderful poster in my kitchen by Kozak of the Thrill Kill cult. So when I saw them, that they were here, I thought, whoa, I got to go to that.
Mm-hmm. And when I look at this picture, I see it so, you know, markedly different than the early work that we started looking at here with the black and white film stuff, and all of a sudden this colored digital stuff in your, and it seems like there's a whole different dynamic here. And so was there some point that you decided, well, I'm going to start shooting again? What was there a cataclysmic moment?
Digital. Mm-hmm. And I just bought a point and shoot digital camera for you know, around the house, and just bought one. And just started shooting and taking it everywhere and carrying it around in my purse, like I do now. I mean, I have a larger camera, not as large as someone's camera. I, you know, today I thought, I'll just bring a little camera with me.
Any of you? This might be my favorite pairing of all of these. Now, I mentioned I observed Chris's work a lot, and it's not the technical ability of his shots that puts him apart, it's the way he puts people at ease that figured out is his secret, right? Like, I can't feel like I can go up to someone and be like, hey! You see all these pictures up, really intimate shots where you really capture people being themselves. And I sort of watch how he interacts, and I see this shot here of Bev's. I saw this, Bev did a 144 punk rock photographs exhibit at Gen Gallery a couple of years ago, and I saw this picture, and this was this huge, you know, because I was 12, 13 years old. I grew up in a really conservative religious family. I know that's shocking. I got a dead Kennedys and God We Trust with the Jesus on the cross, a dollar bill t-shirt, right? And this was the evil dead Kennedys. Oh, the dead Kennedys, the scourge. It's the dead Kennedys. It looks like the IT department. I
But I love this, where it's kind of like, aw, shucks, you know? And then this one here, it's just like, why are they posing, or are they working it, you know? Kris, to start with you, how do you get these shots? Where you put them in these? Are you coaching them? What do you want from the band when you're doing this?
Usually I'm not coaching them. Usually I'm just trying to connect with them and learn as much as I can about them in just a couple of minutes and just make a connection. And a lot of times, like this, I think they were actually fighting about what they were going to pose doing when I took this picture. I think the brunette was kind of frustrated with the blonde girl who wanted to stand in the front.
Sure looks like it, yeah.
So yeah, and by the time they thought they were ready to take photos, we were pretty much done. We had what we needed, so.
Ah, love it. And then this is, are they going just on stage or coming off, or what are they doing?
That was in Victoria at the old age pensioners hall, and I don't know. It's like San Francisco. They used to have their first punk gigs at the, it was a hall for deaf people. Serving coffee and stuff to all the punks who were like totally deaf, which really worked out quite well, I think, for them anyway. I was really surprised when I found this because I had totally forgotten when I printed for that 144 show, I'd totally forgotten I'd ever done any group shots of the DKs. Ever.
Sweet. Let's move to the next one. All right, here is the classic. Every band has to have, like, you know, first when you start a band, you have the name, then you get a cool shot of you hanging out in an alley like a snowman. This is two versions of a very similar kind of thing. Of course, the perspective is different, but both of them have a similar story behind them that I sort of realized accidentally, where it's like, again, going back to what you talked about with the pipettes there in that earlier shot, by the time you're done shooting, by the time they're starting, you're done shooting.
Yeah, I had this location picked out, which was a park about half a block from where we are now, and this was shot on the walk to the park, and we didn't end up really even shooting in the park. But yeah, that was where we were headed. It was like to the spot.
And then, and that's Modi Lemon, DOA here, Bev, that's behind Smiling Buddha.
Yeah, that's the back door of the Smiling Buddha, and they were doing load-in of their equipment, and a friend of mine drove me down into the alleyway, and Chuck always, the drummer at the front, Chuck Biscuits, always carried a paper sack everywhere. And so the first few pictures were Chuck getting the paper sack down onto the ground. And then the next bunch of pictures were everyone getting a cigarette and everyone getting a light. And then they started to pose and I said, well, I'm finished. They go, well, what do you want us to do? And I just said, you've done it. Because I think the relationship, I mean, the band, these guys know me, but the band itself knows each other really, really well. And if you're just photographing their interaction with each other, you can't really go wrong with those pictures. As opposed to going, well, why don't you stand over there? And you know, I don't know the band.
Did somebody just write that down? Put that on the Twitter. That's sage advice right there. I mean, it really is. The band already know each other. Yeah.
And so photograph how they're reacting with each other, which is what you got in that other photograph so well.
And here's Exhibit A to point out the fact of Bev's long relationship with DOA. There's actually a reissue here, but the triumph of the Ignoroids. These little mashup arts and crafts. This wasn't done in Photoshop here in the back. And there it is, sure enough, Bev Davies right there is an earliest, as part of the earliest DOA artifacts. There it is. A little show and tell there. don't put it in your case, though. All right, both of these. This is Dave Gregg, who we just saw earlier in the other DOA shot. But I love this pairing. But this is kind of looking towards, once you get to know an artist, is it easier to shoot them? You know, Bev obviously shot DOA a lot. And then Kris, you know, this shot of Flava Flav there, you know Flav's going to roll around and do crazy shit on the ground. Do you anticipate that and sort of set up for those kind of shots? Or do you just go with the flow?
This was a free show in a park in South by Southwest, and most of them are free. And this show was nuts. And, like, security was nuts, and there was gangbanger. It was nuts. So this was not me doing anything special other than, like, wedge myself into the tiny little spot that I had. And just, that was, I think, the only angle I had on the stage that time.
And then, Bev, was Dave Gregg doing this throughout the tour,
I think Joe or Randy told me that Dave was doing this, to watch for him doing this, when he got the lighter fluid out to get a shot at that, because they'd come up through the West Coast and he'd been doing it. So I got these shots, knew about it, I mean, he just loved Jimi Hendrix, so that was his ode to Jimi Hendrix there.
Does his guitar withstand that and he plays it again?
Well, it did for a long time, evidently, because I heard later they continued on the tour across Canada, and at some point, and then maybe headed down through the Midwest, at some point he was playing his guitar and it just exploded. And there was like no oxygen left in the plastic, I guess, it just got
all right. What makes the perfect rock and roll shot? Is it the technical focus, exposure, all this stuff, or is it the vibe and the personality? When I look at both of these shots, I say, okay, I'm not a technical photographer, I don't know, fancy stuff. I say, okay, that one's maybe a little bit too much light, and that one can have more confidence or whatever. But I look at both these shots and I see rock and roll performers at the top of their game with the audience in complete control, even though you don't see the audience. And to me, these kind of shots almost are the perfect rock and roll shot. Am I wrong? Is it the personality of the person, or is it the technical bits and pieces?
It's the emotional impact, and I think that can come from either capturing the spirit of the particular event you're at, the particular show, or of the artist that you're trying to capture. But I think it's the emotional impact.
What do you think, Beth?
I had a little argument with the people when I posted that on that rock and roll thing, which I, on Flickr, every now and again, I post stuff in this rock and roll thing, just so they'll cut me down to size. And they were going, well, it's not bad, but really what makes it is the person. That isn't important, really. It's got to be a good shot, no matter who it is. Frig. I like the shape of his arm. That's what I like about this picture. I love the fact that it's Joe Strummer, and I love the fact that he's on stage and he's probably talking. But the shape of his arm is what makes the picture. It warmed me inside as I look at the shape of his arm.
What year is that?
1983 at the US Festival in San Bernardino. It was the last time that Mick Jones played with the Clash.
Yep. And Kris, this is
he's not in this picture.
Joe Strummer had some problems. This was the Police's dress rehearsal before the first official show, and if I recall correctly, you only had official media credentials and maybe had a little altercation with those photos?
Yeah, I mean, I get accreditation as often as I can and work for that and strive for that, but I also won't take no for an answer, so I snuck my camera in on this one and was kind of bopping in and out of places to stay off the radar, and I actually ended up getting busted in the end, but I had 3 memory cards that I was swapping out every time I changed positions in my pocket, so when I got busted, I only had 2 shots of Sting on my memory card, so I happily deleted them for them right there.
I had that same version for a lot of stuff. It was the roll of film in the bra. Not even in the camera bag, but in the bra.
Yeah. Is that the worst that's happened to you, though? I mean, like, they just make you delete them.
I also have to check my camera in after that, but I don't think, I mean, they could eject you, but I don't think I've ever been ejected out of anything.
But they actually won't take the camera.
Well, I'd like to see them try.
I wouldn't put anything past the dark side, Live Nation. I honestly wouldn't. I couldn't say enough about how bad they are to deal with as a photographer, but I don't want to get blacklisted from the one.
I was just going to say the same thing. I can't agree with you because I'm on the good list for right now.
But even today, when everybody's taking photos,
but I just find, you know, this fear that I hold about them.
I think they're missing the boat on not having a couple great house photographers for the Commodore. In the same spirit of me saying that I think you helped build the scene by photo documenting everything, getting in people's hands. What if the Commodore said that you and I could be house and pop in today's show, we wanted to do whatever we want with the photos. Like, how much of a reputation and a scene would we be building? The Commodore's a great venue.
They don't care because they just bought Ticketmaster. They control the universe.
Yeah,
right,
it's got to be about more than that.
All right, we'll change the world shortly with Live Nation. Heavy Peter. Rock and roll shows, I've noticed fellas are jumping around, moving all fast, they're playing instruments. Sometimes the lighting's a little dodgy, and the folks at Live Nation, they don't allow you to take flash photos and stuff when you go in there. From a technical, starting to get a little bit technical, how do you go in there and, like, you know, this is sort of a shot here where you're capturing everything with just enough motion here. Or, you know, this with him in full swing, Randy Rampage, who's got the foulest mouth of anyone I've ever met in my life, he's a very sweet man. How do you go in and capture these shots? Do you have a game plan set up from the technical standpoint?
Stand at the front.
Point at subject.
Yeah.
You hear that, kids? Oh, circulate this around.
No, I did go to Chicago to get that one, though, so, you know, mortgage your life and buy an airplane to Chicago. They were the first band that played live in Chicago's Lincoln Park after the Democratic riots. Many, many years later, they were the first band to play live.
But they're sweet guys with no political agenda, not known for rabble-rousing. Now, Kris, with the Flaming Lip shot, I saw, like, you know, I remember you put these shots up from South By, and there was a few companion pieces that were the same kind of, you know, great contrast and everything. But then I saw some other pictures from that same show where there were, you know, you saw the backgrounds and things like that. Did you know you were going to get the shots like this when you were squeezing the trigger?
I have the good fortune of not having gone to photography school or really know anything about how to do photography for real, so I push my camera to places where most people don't go, or they've been told not to, or different things. So this was shot at like 3200 ISO on a 20D several years ago. So I mean, it wasn't, you know, you're not supposed to do that. People will tell you can't republish your photos, or they're going to become pixelated and grainy. But the pixelation just adds to the confetti factor and kind of that weirdness around the lights there behind the guy's head. And that's an artifact of the 3200 ISO. I didn't know I was going to get this exactly. What I did was, I learned, this is the show where I learned to set it on TV, like the shutter priority value for shooting concert photography, because I wanted as much depth of field as possible, but I never wanted the shot to go below like 1/200th of a second, because then it would get blurry and you wouldn't capture the stuff. So I kind of switched back and forth from time to time, but this is where I learned that I really wanted to kind of freeze the motion, freeze the confetti and the smoke in the air, and I had to shoot at fast shutter speeds to do that, and it was flexible in the aperture.
Photo geeks getting happy. workflow. Bev, back in the day, this was when we spoke a couple weeks ago.
As I blogged on my blog, bevdavies.com, if there really was a back in the day, then I wouldn't be old, because it would only been one day. So I'd only be 2 days old. There were a lot of days.
You shoot off a roll of film, you take it back to the lab, you develop, you hold the negative up to the light, or whatever, and you basically choose one picture to print, maybe two. One would go in the Georgia Strait, guys like me would run out to it. On Thursday, you can only get to Georgia Strait at max.
In Surrey, you gotta remember.
Yeah. It was and there would be the one picture representing that week's music by Bev Davies. And then all these other negatives, they would go into plastic sleeves and be stored away for future days.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
What should become of these?
Well, that's how I found the Dead Kennedy group shot, is I had no idea it was there. And what I was doing to do for the 100, so for the 144 photographs, I sort of got a book that I thought had 144 pages in it, and I put number one and decided what number one picture was going to be and went and hunted for it, and sort of worked that way for a while, and then decided that I would branch out into stuff that I hadn't really looked at before. So I started scanning it into the computer and just doing the quick scan and looking at it and going, okay, I like that one, and taking it out and taking it in the dark room, because they were all printed by hand for that show. So I found a lot of stuff that I had never laid eyes on. And I've been scanning for 2 years now. It takes about 45 minutes to scan 12 pictures. And I have the patience to do maybe 24 at the most in a day. Yeah, I have two interns that are waiting to come and look at my
notes. Interns? I'll give you your card later.
From their library interns, and they're going to set up a database thing.
Bless those dear interns.
Yeah.
And Kris, you know, you shoot a lot of pictures. This last week alone, while you're busy partying with some models in New York, blah, 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 just had a week with Kris Krug. You filled up a couple hard drives then, probably, and, you know, I think if you're just going through and thinking in terms of looking at a negative and just saying, oh, I got to pick out two shots of the thing, this isn't a shot that you would probably pull up, just two dudes looking kind of nebbish and you know, some commotion in the background, but I find this shot really endearing. This Vampire Weekend, probably just before, after a show, these are a couple guys who are, wow, man, 6 months ago we were going to community college, and now there's all these people that are watching our show. How do you pull a picture like that out of these massive piles of pictures that you've taken?
Well, it's interesting. This photo and a bunch of the other ones that you've hit on in your presentation have all been film shots. So even though
I'm a sucker for that.
Even though I do go to these shows and blow away a whole bunch of digital stuff, I also just do a few film ones. And, you know, oftentimes the digital's safe. You know you're going to get what you're going to get. You can check it out right there and get it off to editors or different people right away. But the film stuff is, I love it more every single time. Every time I shoot both images, I always love the film stuff better.
Analog.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. I mean, I think you definitely take a closer look. Like my editing process is different with film. I might have thrown this away had it been a digital shot. I might have overlooked it or missed it because there's just three film ones as opposed to 30 digital ones. You kind of slow down a bit, compose better, and spend more time looking at the special stuff in them.
Mm-hmm. And the same thing with this shot here, Bev. You know, with the black on black here and the weird angle and everything. At first blush, it wouldn't seem like it's a well-composed photograph. Per se, but it captures such great emotion.
That's the slits, and I've only seen them once, and I saw them in England, and I saw them at some movie theater, and I was looking through Time Out, and I went, wow, they're showing a movie about the slits, or maybe it's the slits playing live. So I phoned, and it was, and they put me on the list. I had no idea how to find the theater, and they told me where the nearest tube station was. So I went to there, and I looked around for the first punk. And I said, can you tell me how to get to whatever the theater was? And he said, yeah. I said, do you have a ticket? He said, no. And I said, if I get you in for free, will you walk me there so I can find? Because how to get there was really complicated. But it just was a fluke kind of thing. And in watching them, I took a lot more pictures of the woman that's the very Courtney Love kind of looking woman, but way before Courtney, on the left-hand side. She was the more sort of dynamic, but then the leader of the group and the one who has remained famous, if we can use that, is the woman in the center area.
Yeah.
All right, hit me, Peter. Now this is when I started to go, oh, geez. Work is almost colliding. And as I put these photos together, I'm like, oh, who is who? Again. But the thing that really struck me about these, it's not about the faces, it's about the personality. Some of the people we've seen in these pictures, they're famous, you recognize Sting's face. And I resisted the temptation to put Sting with Sting on that. I figured his ego was big enough. He did need two pictures on the thing. But it's just, there's something here about the shape of the body, the shape of the action is the part of these pictures. It's hard to figure out who the fans are. It's dead Confederate and someone else, but...
Place the very strange.
There you go. Why does this shot like this matter? Does it matter who it is or just the fact that it's happening? If someone's on stage rocking somewhere?
Well, I know for me with these strobe light and backlit things, I have to give up on what I normally do, which is focus for the eyes, try to get at least some detail in the face. All of a sudden, I have to realize that the whole thing is a shape and start shooting for the shape rather than the content and let the shape tell the story of the picture. Him there.
Yeah, and I think this one just goes to that point of the emotional impact. I mean, there's so much pent-up energy in that shot. Like, it immediately takes me back there. It makes me want to go back there. And you just want to see him rock out. I mean, you can feel it in his hair, in the way he's gripping his guitar, and his body's all bent. I mean, you want to teleport right back.
Ooh, he's deeper than me.
Teleport right back on in.
Bev, can you time travel with your photos?
No.
Have you tried?
We talked. Way earlier, I told you folks that I collected. Mm-hmm. I didn't think I was cementing a scene or helping create it or any of that stuff. I was collecting. And part of my reason to collect was a feeling that if I collected all the information, I could go back. That if you collect enough information about something, then you can go back in time. You can't. I don't think. I haven't figured out how to do it yet, anyway.
All right, Peter. Sometimes, again, kind of the faces aren't important, maybe the whole body's not important. There's two things that caught me about this picture. Bev, I've learned the difference and the importance to you about the difference between runners and shoes. And I've noticed a lot of shoe pictures in your shot, but this one I gave you the bonus part of this great lighting on the face. And this is also coming from a more backstage perspective. What went into this shot? Do you know what you're doing?
It's digital, so I got to look at pictures, didn't I? You work through, because there's there's a lot of time at a show like at Richards on Richards where you're allowed to shoot the whole show. There's a lot of time. You can see what was working, what you thought was working, give it another try, you know, try another angle on stuff. And I just was standing back in one area and discovered that I liked the shape of, again, shape, the shape of how his leg was, and just started shooting that.
Yeah, to me, that's just an amazingly composed set.
But the other thing you were alluding to is the shoes.
Yeah.
Now, Carola, my friend Carola, that owns the Gem Gallery, another plug, she and I have discovered, starting with the Brian Jonestown Massacre, that they all wear shoes.
Not shoes.
Like, I don't mean not bare feet, but they got men's shoes on rather than running shoes. And then we started, we were at the Virgin Festival or something. She had a gallery table, so we couldn't both go watch a band. We listened to them for a while, and then one of us would go over to check out their footwear. And we'd make a decision before the person went whether we liked them or not, and then check. And unfailingly that day, if we didn't like them, listening to them, they had runners on. So that's become our... Now, drummers, they're exempt from that. But it just seems to be that, and DOA is exempt.
Yeah.
There's a few bands that have worked their way up through runners that they've exempted themselves. Because Carola, I mean, she loved this band, and she said, look, he's got shoes on. That was her way of telling me, I like this band.
Now, Kris, you also like shoes, I see.
Yeah, I wish I had a good story for this. Yours is way deeper in this case. I couldn't stop. This is the girl from Kiss Me Deadly, and she was amazing, and I caught her eye at the beginning of the show, and I couldn't stop looking at her red one-piece jumpsuit. She was like reflecting light like a fishing lure, and it was red.
Yeah. All right, Peter, quick. All right. Part of my personal hero is Billy Bragg. This is at South by Southwest. This is Acid Mother Temple here on the side. When you go in to do a shoot, do you have a, well, again, we kind of alluded to this earlier, you go in with the game plan when you're shooting for a pro gig where it's like, I get the singer, I get a portrait, I get the whole group shot. So I want to go back to that and say, do you go in with much of a game plan with this, or was this just using, seeing this crazy light that you have and going with it? Or was it part of a bigger idea? And when you go in, like, do you do a setup pack? Oh, I gotta get one of this, I gotta get a long shot, a left shot, a right shot?
This is what I didn't know what I was getting myself into, because it was a huge, what do you call it, like a collaboration festival where all the dudes kept coming out. And okay. Now another star, and now another guy. So I was just trying to get some portraits of him, catch a bit of the like attitude that he had that night. This one, I think I actually got lucky. I think this is, the lights are moving, right? They're like, it wasn't like a hair light or a catch light on his head, so that was a kind of a happy accident that got lit up with the rim light that way.
You know, with this shot here, Bev, it almost looked like a Kris Krug cross-process shot with this the crazy contrast up there in the corner. Did this happen by design, or did you see that light when you were doing it?
I've shot, this is at Pat's Pub, and I've shot there before with the transmitters and found this luminous green and yellow quality happening. So I was quite aware it was there and shot from this side of the stage to try to get it into some shots. Because the other side of the stage, you just get the mixing board and the person sitting at them not right. So good, you know? But I love psychedelic, modern psychedelic bands. So when I saw there was this band coming, and, you know, they were talking about acid and stuff in the name. I just knew that I would like them. But I had no idea what they looked like. And when they were sitting around before they went on stage, I went, wow, I really want to get some good shots of this person. So okay. I did. I bracketed and got a shot of the drummer and got a shot of the bass player and that kind of stuff, because you never know what they might use it for. But I just wanted to get some shots of him. And then there's an English psychedelic magazine that I was thinking about doing some online magazine doing some psychedelic shots, and I sent them one of these, and I actually took this in, one of these pictures into Photoshop to try to make it more psychedelic, and it was totally impossible. Anything I tried doing to it just ruined it. It's like totally psychedelic enough.
All right, Timmy, Peter, I'm going to keep rolling through here because there's a few more awesome shots I want to show you, and I don't want anyone disappearing and missing out on any of the stuff. Oh, I love this pairing here. It's almost uncanny. This is Madonna's first tour, first concert, I do believe. Jack White there, and it's like they're both of these shots I see, like compared to that Sting and Joe Strummer shot where they're like, I'm peak of my career and I rule you all. This is like, I'm still trying really hard and hoping I'm doing a good job, kind of look on this. So I wanted to bring up the other point about access, and we touched on this a little bit, but how do you form those relationships to get in to shoot bigger acts like this? It's one thing to shoot your buddy's punk band, but it's another thing to get in and allow with the camera in there. You want to hit it off, Kris?
I don't know, I think of it all as like little secret agent missions. So I try to find all the entrances and exits and who's in charge of all the different spots and just introduce myself and be friendly and show people the photos that I take on the spot so they get an idea of what I'm doing and kind of want to be a part of it or feel some sort of association with, let me get into good spots so I get good photos and show them and kind of include them in it. But
you ever bribe security? Roadie?
I've bought a few drinks after the fact. I mean, it's always the same dudes at all the different places, so... you know, life's long, and you wanna not like burn it all out at the same one shot or whatever. So I bought drinks, but I'd rather bribe anyone or wanted to. Or
besides shooting DOA back in these days, you were shooting these other emerging and bigger artists. How old was the difference like? What did you have to go through to get the credentials?
Well, I was shooting for the province that night because it was in Seattle, and that's before their union stepped in and wouldn't let photographers shoot. So they weren't going to spend the money to send someone to Seattle. So they sent their writer, Tom Harrison, and his wife, Carrie, went.
Right, called Bruno Jerusi's medallion.
Yeah. I used to wonder if it was Bruno Jerusi's gold medallion, then I realized, who needs the word gold?
Yes, of course,
obvious.
Bruno fucking Jerusi, man.
So I was shooting for the province, so the pass was no problem. You know, getting down there, driving down, I had to take the bus back because they were staying down for a while. But they did this whole thing where they had all the press people come in and shoot for three songs in the front pit. Mm-hmm. And then I noticed that people had cameras in the venue. So I just went back into the venue and shot from the venue. And this was later on in the show when she'd taken her jacket off. So this was not shot from the pit. It was shot from where someone could be sitting beside me shooting also.
So you mean to tell me for 30 years the mainstream media and the audience social media creation engine has been there and no one has sorted it out yet? Hit me here. Now, I called Bono's people to say, you know, I'm doing this little photo pairing thing. I know Bono, and I said, here's a list. I can put them with Sting, I can put them with Stipe, and I can put them with Lemmy. And they're like, Lemmy, and that's it. So here you have a young Ernest Bono without sunglasses. Look at that, his head was only tiny then, right? And I also resisted the temptation to use Bev's shot of Lemmy and you shot Motorhead. This was a great story where you had permission to shoot Motorhead, but then you went to the door, and what happened?
They wouldn't let me into the venue because Ozzy Osbourne was the headliner, and I didn't have permission to shoot Ozzy.
Ozzy has immediate exposure.
I don't want to shoot Ozzy. I just want to shoot Motorhead. And I had the Motorhead passes stuck on me, and they wouldn't let me in. So the record rep Monica brought them out into the backyard because I met them that afternoon at an in-store, and they came out into the playing field behind and did a roll of film shooting.
That's awesome. So instead of shooting Motorhead on stage in the rock and roll environment, they're at the park standing in front of some trees.
Yeah, making fun of Ozzy and what he sounded like coming out of the building.
Oh, you're right. That's awesome.
I say, God, he's rinky dink. Listen to him.
Yeah, to me, these are both these kind of iconic shots here. When
he's doing Sunday Bloody Sunday in this one.
Nice.
Yeah. I mean, it's fantastic. When you're shooting something like that, and when you're shooting bands, you say,
those guys didn't like that either on Flickr. They said, it's not that good.
This is one of my new favorite Bono photos. I love this.
Yeah.
And
it could have been photoshopped a bit. I mean, they were just ruthless.
Ruthless. But the fact that you're there and you're going to see all these bands, now there's lots of bands that you went to see when you shot that, you know, you could put up and the picture might be equally good, but the dude's face is different than Bono's. It's not Bono there, and they went on and they're working as at the used car lot now.
He's short. He's really short. I was really surprised at how, because I saw him again, because they played here, and then like 2 or 3 days later, they played the US Festival in San Bernardino. And I saw him in the kit early in the day, and I thought, my God, you look short compared to what you look like on the stage.
So you see a band like this, do you think they might turn into something? And same thing here, Kris, when you shoot a guy like Lemmy, and you go, oh, this is a guy that's been at this for 30-some-odd years. Are you aware of the history, or is it just a shot and a pose, and it doesn't matter?
Oh, yeah, for sure. I felt honored to be able to even see them play, much less be able to take some of these photographs. I mean, I wish I could shoot them when they were young, and follow them when they were young.
Look at the cardinals on his face.
Amazing.
All right. Yeah. I'll keep rocking, because I want to let you get out of here.
You're out of time? Yeah, you're out of time. Sorry.
Oh, come on, give me one
just
more.
Just go through
one more. All right, that was awesome. Isn't that cool? Love this line here, girls. Yeah, yeah, go, girls, hit me. These are just intimate portraits. Henry Rollins is looking right at you here, Beth. There's a cover of
With hatred.
So young.
A little band called R.E.M. there on the cover of that fanzine. Ben Harper just laying his soul out. And here's, look at this. Oh, I love this. Downtown Vancouver, that just says that to me right there. And I had a question for this, but I'm going to skip it in the interest of time so I can show you one final shot to show that a role in Bev's photography was inspiring young social media makers. There's some guy going,
did she take your pictures?
So, and to bring this full circle, the band of scores, they never released an album, and now years. This is 83 in Surrey, and now they've compiled all their old recordings, and they're actually, the Spores are finally releasing their first album here in 2009, and in New York Magazine asked Beth, do you have any pictures of this band called the Spores? And sure enough, there it is with someone there in the front row. And from that same, this is from a different show of the Spores. This is probably the only, I'm probably the only bastard who held on to this for all this year who said that as well, but I have some other things to show you, Bev, that you guys are going to miss out on, because we're out of time. My name's Dave. This is Bev, this is Kris, and there's some URLs. Give me Peter.
Oh, one more.
And thanks, Peter, for driving us out.